Hey ladies, I want to tell you about a very special event that I'm holding this October. It's my live virtual event called Ignite Your Life, and I really want you to attend. This 3-day virtual experience is designed for smart, successful women just like you so that you can become your authentically beautiful self. You'll learn how to attract a high-quality man and propel you forward on the right path to love. This event is taking place October 14th through the 16th, and it will be the only event of its kind this year. I want you to join us and a whole community of really successful women for this transformative 3-day event where you're going to learn the unique process that will help you attract an amazing man who is completely enchanted by you. I'm also giving you a special gift because you're part of our amazing and supportive podcast community. For the first 50 women who sign up to go to Ignite Your Life from our podcast community, I'm giving you $20 off the ticket price. So to access this discount, use the promo code by typing the word IGNITE at checkout. You'll save your spot for just $77, but you must act quickly because these spots are filling up fast. So to register, go to IYLVIP.com or find the link in our show notes. We look forward to seeing you there.
You're listening to Life Check Yourself with life coach, transformational leader, and dating and relationship badass, Marni Batista. Every week, you'll get the raw truth from top experts and real people on the important life and love issues you want to know about. So if you're ready to life check yourself in your relationships, your career, and the areas of your life that matter most to you, and you're not afraid to be called out on your stuff, then you're ready for what's next.
Life check yourself with Chris and Dr. Emily. The number one question you ask a man after the one you ask about his relationship goals.
Ladies, you know, my husband's British, so I've been watching a lot of the Queen's funeral. Feeling the same about the Bachelorette. Like after 73 years, it's the end of a legacy and King Charles will be cool, but he'll never be the Queen. And Jeremy was like, maybe we should go back and watch like the first two episodes of The Bachelor and The Bachelorette just to see what it would be like, you know, like, you know, back when the monarchy meant something. So, I mean, just gosh. So I think one thing that is just really clear that I want to just start with is it's so ridiculous, but it's so important. The importance of making sure your person is looking for the same thing. And this is what my clients actually really struggle with, what I call the follow-up question, which is, what do you mean by that exactly? Yeah. Right? Like, I want to get engaged. I could be engaged. I would love to get engaged. What do you mean by that exactly? Yeah. Let's just start there. You guys said 4 out of the 6? Or is it 6 out of the 6 don't want to be engaged?
Well, no, Zach, I think what happened, I think we're at 5 out of 6.
Yeah. Yeah. Eric is still there. So yeah, I guess it would have been 4 out of 6. So Eric and Zach.
Eric doesn't want to get engaged.
Zach would have gotten engaged for
Zach
sure.
Zach would have been the only one who would have 100%, no questions, got engaged.
And you know who else, Marni, would have got engaged? That goddamn NASCAR drag racing guy in the first episode she kicked off.
he would have totally gotten engaged.
Here we are.
It's just, well, I love that you guys put in this like show note that we were talking about like what, you know, what is it that the contestant, and we talked about this last week, and this is why I loved it, but now I'm like already bored of that, which is like, they won't play along with the narrative of the whirlwind romance. And Eric says to Gabby, like, yeah, like, I'd like to leave here with you. Like, shouldn't we date before we get engaged? And Avon is like, which by the way, on Reddit, I noticed that Avon is called like Ivan. Aaron, Avin, Avi, whatever. It's funny. Nobody knows his name, but he's like, I really would like to like date, and like you come to Florida, and I'll come to blah blah blah, and like, and so the, The value is on in this show, and we'll talk about how does that connect with real life. But it's like, I just want to win. Like, I just want to get the ring. I just want to get the proposal. Yeah. I just want to get, you know, and I don't care about the person. And that is just horrifying to me.
Yeah. You know what? And Marni, I love that you point out, because there are, I have so many, I've heard it so many times, female, I dated the girls, like, I just have to get married by the time I'm 30. To anybody? Does it matter? Just a warm pulse? I think you're right. That is like they've made their mind up, and you see Rachel's mind melting because that's what her goal was. And she's now you're embarrassing her in front of her family, and not so much about who you're going to marry, but the more important that she ticks that box and says she can cross that to-do list off and got married on the TV.
Well, it's interesting. It's like, and I think that it says a lot about the, this not the stigma, but the illusion of the goal. And I think in some ways it's a reflection of society that, in that, you know, we have these shoulds about like, we're supposed to go to this school and we're supposed to get this job and we're supposed to have this kind of relationship and all these sorts of things. And then you look at what normal humans do is you look at like the people that have gone before you. And so in this show, like, I get it. Like, they've watched The Bachelorette. There's a person, there's three guys. They all want to marry you. That's what it's supposed to be. And I think the learning for our listeners, besides the follow-up question, is like how you get so attached to what you think you want that you're not being present to what is happening. And the way their nervous systems get so dysregulated because they're so attached about the way they want it to look that they're not listening and not able to really be present for this conversation. Because what Avon says is like, you're not listening to me. Like, I want to be with you. Like, if you think this is me rejecting you, it's not.
Yeah.
And I think that happens in dating, you know, like you want this guy to be this certain way. Like, you want him to like, you know, not invite you to Starbucks and invite you to like the cool, trendy coffee shop. And you just can't be with what is. So you rule people out when they might be your partner because you're attached to what you think dating or the guy is supposed to look like. And both these ladies do not know how to like regulate to have actual conversations.
And I was going to flip that on its head and to the converse is, I think what I see a lot is as well is he's telling you he's looking for the door and that he doesn't want to, keeps taking you to Starbucks, even though he heard you. He purposely, you're there just because the Starbucks is on the way home from his house and got a big parking lot. And he's hooking you up there and he's going to drop you off and head back home. So, and all, some people are like, oh, well, maybe right. Next time.
Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
That's true too. But Dr. Emily, don't you, I mean, I haven't read, you know, online a lot of stuff, but I don't think that Avon or Eric are like bad guys. I think they're just like, I like you. I'm falling for you. I even love you, but like, I've known you for 2 weeks.
Yeah, no. I think what Chris was saying was probably what Jason and Johnny were like.
Yes. Yes.
And this week we do have two really seemingly high quality guys who are saying the most reasonable thing ever. It's the most reasonable ask to be like, can I see where you live first? Can I see what your house, like, are you messy? Are you like, it's just so unbelievably reasonable. And I completely agree. Rachel especially has completely missed the forest for the trees. Like, she is just so focused on, and it you can hear it when she's talking to her family. She's like, I said I was not going to come home unless I'm engaged. And just made up I always think I'm like, you literally made up, you completely fabricated a rule for yourself that you and you are the only one who cares about that rule. No, your family's not going to be disappointed if you don't come home engaged. You are the only one who feels the need to abide to this rule, and so now you're gonna let go the guy who, and I was shocked, I was just so shocked that it really did seem like Avon was her first hit. And so you're going to let him go because he won't get engaged in 48 hours. Mm-hmm. Like, that is completely missing. You're missing what is the long-term goal here. What do I actually, do I actually want a husband, or do I want to say, okay, I got engaged on The Bachelor? Like,
yeah. And I think it, and it's so, and this is, if you reflect it back to the whole journey, like if you have low self-worth and you live to not be rejected, then every single action that is emanating from that core belief will drive you on this path to the landing point. To where in the end you and this is like really amazing women sabotage shit all day long because there's like a great guy and you can't, like, maybe it is Zach, like maybe he is too nice for you. I don't know. Like, but the bottom line is, like, I am so attached that I can't actually make conscious choices. And then you sabotage, because if you don't heal that core wound of like, just, I want someone to pick me. And what she said is, and I'd love for you guys to comment on this, is like, you should know now. Like, if you don't know right now, that means you actually don't love me, or you actually aren't interested. Mm-hmm. Like, you need to know now. What?
Right. Yeah. It's like how she prescribed if then statement, and if you don't do this, then it must mean, again, all about me. It must mean that you don't love me, or okay, I'm not lovable, or I'm not. I think we kind of sussed out that her narrative, repeating narratives, like she's not chosen or worthy of being chosen again. And almost, yeah, I like what you said, how when a person is so dead set on, I don't know, trying not to think that there's an elephant in a room, that every time something bad happens, she comes up to, well, is that the elephant? Must have been the elephant shit, or something had to do with the elephant. She's constantly trying to make it about, even when Avon was trying to explain and she just didn't hear anything. You saw her not passively listening, but she just like, hurry, just leave. I want to soak and marinate in this gooey, nasty, you know, bathtub full of ick that's my ego and that's my comfortable place. She just wanted to feel sorry for herself. Like, no. Look at me. And she couldn't even like look at him and give him a kiss goodbye. It was like, kind of perfect.
Yeah. And so let's break down that communication. Like, she's like, you're shouting at me, or you're raising your voice at me. I mean, what do you guys think about, like, I thought that he was totally being reasonable. He said, I'm sorry, I'm passionate, I'm frustrated. I don't know, Chris and Emily, you guys are always on like what the Reddit and what Twitter is. Are people saying like, you know, he gaslighted her? I mean,
yeah, no, there are still a lot of mostly apologists, but Reddit's funny because it's all organized by, if you like it, it goes to the top. Well, after you get from the first, there is the truth, like, lies closer to the middle, just like, you know, like a lot of real life. And then it starts coming. Yeah, in the middle, people are like, wow, I used to be, you know, I'm all constantly defending her, but that's bullshit. I've been in, you know, I've been in arguments and been yelled at. I wasn't screaming or whatever it was at me. And I mean, good Lord, if her threshold was that, I felt like in that point, she's just like, yep. I have to move on. I don't know. Maybe it's not being chosen.
It wasn't being chosen. And he was like, you're not listening to me. Yeah. Like, I really felt like she wasn't listening to him. She had zero empathy. Like, she couldn't understand how it was to be him. And she's just making it all about her. And I was thinking for Zach and Avon, like, in the end, I'd be like, I dodged a goddamn bullet. Yeah. This girl cannot listen. She cannot problem solve. She, like, thank you, sweet Lord above, that, like, you know, I didn't want to engage. And this is exactly why he wants more time. He's like, and how do we solve problems? You know, how do we deal with conflict? Like, I'm not going to, and also I'm not going to just play this engagement game. He even said this. On the show, what happens is they play the engagement game. They get engaged. They full know well that it's actually, we're just going to date, but I'm going to wear Neil Lane's ring and we're going to be on Instagram together. And he's like, no, let's do it the other way. Let's actually date and not get engaged on TV and then actually have a family. It's so fucking reasonable.
Yeah. It really, and what I think was going on was she so badly wanted to, was trying to construe the conversation that he was rejecting her.
Yes.
And that's what he got so frustrated by, because in reality, she is rejecting him. She is giving him an ultimatum saying, if you don't propose in 48 hours, we're done. And she didn't, she wouldn't say that because she knows how crazy that sounds.
Yeah.
So instead, you don't love me enough. You do this, you blah, blah, blah. And that's where he was like, I'm just talking to a brick wall. Like nothing I'm saying even matters.
And so Rachel, let's just say, in the list of things she needs to work on in therapy, is that she's not direct. So she can't tell Zach, like, I'm not feeling it. I can't get there with you.
Yeah.
Like, we shouldn't go to the fantasy suite. Instead, she does some, like, manipulation of, like, weirdness where he's like, you're weird. Like, and then she does it again. Like, she can't be direct. Like, here's the thing. Like, I want to be engaged at the end of this. Like, I'll totally play the game. Like, we'll just engage and then I'll date you and no pressure. But I really would like to end this game like that. Are you down? That's a conversation she should have had in the fantasy suite.
Yeah.
Right. Like, we're both going to be influencers. Let's come up with a game plan. How do you want to do this to get the most followers? Literally. Right. Or fuck that. Like, I'm not interested in that. This is what I really want. Like, there was no, because we all know it's a game and they have that fantasy suite night. It sounds like have a real conversation about like, what do you really want to do and how's it really going to go down? And
yeah,
it was just, she's not direct. She wasn't being direct.
Right. I guess, there's a couple. My theory, and I'd love to hear your guys', is that she slept with two of the guys, didn't want to be a three-time offender or pull a Clayton who she loathes / you know, wants to be like, or respects us to learn from. And then, so she realized, what'd she say? Yeah. Went all the way with Avon, or he was all like, what was over saucy words, or he was all that or something. And then, when it came down time to him, that she was just, like you said, instead of just being direct, she's like, well, he's here, he's nice. And the internet theory is that she was looking. I definitely saw, I mean, from a little camera time, they saw that she was like, looking to pick a fight about the coffee being shit.
Yeah,
or whatever.
Exactly.
Like, just picking at him. Like, now you're just being mean. Just be nice to the guy and just say, hey, you know what? Gosh, it's been such an awesome journey. The connection's just not there. It's with further along with other people and supposed to get married in next week or whatever. But some of the internet theory is that they started talking about, she started picking and fighting something to different, like religion or something like that. And that Bachelor didn't want to touch it with 10-foot pole. So they were just kind of edited around it and said, all right, just, they didn't really said nothing. What the heck?
No, we don't really know what, except the age thing. I think the lesson is like, if you're not direct in one part of your life, you're just not going to be direct and it's going to come back to bite you in the ass for sure. And then let's also talk about like Tino, like, is Tino her second? Like, is she just going to be like, oh my God, well, whoever, she has pick me energy. So anybody who picks me is who I love. And by the way, that's how I chose my first husband. I'm like, oh, we had sex on the first date and you called me. I guess I should like you. Oh, you want to get married? Okay. Well, no one else has even asked me out on a fifth date. Okay. You know, like, it's picking by who is interested in you. And that is really what she's doing, right? It's like, oh, well, you know, he likes me. He's going to play the game. And therefore, now I accidentally saw a little thing that said, don't say.
No, are you going to say it? Is it gonna, how big of a spoiler is this?
It's not really a spoiler in that she, you know, she, let me just say this, whatever it is that you don't fully address will show up in your relationship later.
Yeah.
Okay.
Right.
Okay.
Right. So whatever it is, whether she marries these guys or they don't, the conversation with Avon, between Rachel and Avon, obviously there's some serious shit. Like, I was like, oh, maybe she's single. And then actually now they could date. Right. Right, because they never really resolve the core issue and they sit across from each other and there's obviously some stuff there.
Yeah.
Right. And so like, if you just brush stuff away and get married or and continue to date someone and you never really deal with it, it's going to pop up like years later or a year later or six months later. So when you have these core misunderstandings about expectations, like if you don't talk about it We both like surfing, you know, like none of that matters in the end.
Right.
Right.
So Marni, you're saying conflict can be very good in a relationship and healthy.
Yeah. I think you have to figure out how to get back to compatibility. And that's why I was saying, like, Zach and honestly, all of them, I hope none of them get married, because let's talk about Gabby for a second and her identity to her wounding and her trauma.
Yeah.
Like she literally can't even, like, her love limit is so tiny that when she feels joy or love or possibility, it's so overwhelming to her little lizard brain that she automatically defaults to fear.
Yeah.
And like, our honey, you need to go, you need some more work, because I don't know, Dr. Emily, what do you think about that?
I have the same, just kind of like, oh, just like sad. Like, I just want to like pet her little head. Yeah. Like, oh, you poor thing. But the interesting thing is, though, I have more hope in her ability to be flexible with Eric than I do Rachel. Rachel is so rigid in her rule, I must get engaged, that whatever, she's just going to blow through everything, because it's not going to, obviously, we saw the preview, it's not going to be perfect with Tino either. So I don't think she's going to end up with anybody. But Gabby, we've at least seen with Jason, she did have the willingness to be a little flexible. Okay, we can just do a long-term relationship. So I think at least I hope she'll come around. But yeah, again, we see her, and this is again what I'm saying, like, if so many people have this core, we call it a core belief of I'm unlovable. And it's not, we don't call it a core belief because it's true. It's like, that's just what you struggle with.
Right.
And you can't try to prove or disprove that. It is unprovable or undisprovable. You can't walk around the world saying, well, if this happens, then it means I'm lovable. If this happens, it means I'm unlovable. Like, you will never, ever win that game. And that's what she's trying so hard to do, is prove that I'm lovable. He can't. No one can. You have to drop that battle and like come to something else, come to kind of like a more surface level belief of, you know, okay, if this guy is really into me, then how about I try, having this tough conversation with him and expressing my needs, and let's see what happens out of that. Like, it's more of an accomplishable goal to say, can I find a guy who will listen to my needs, who will respect my needs, who will have a tough conversation with me? We can, have a back and forth, that we can have a disagreement, God forbid, about something, and come to a mutual understanding. Like, that's an accomplishable goal.
Right. You can't like get someone to like fill the hole in your soul.
Yeah,
and that's why I think that these guys are dodging a bullet, is because if every time your partner says like, I'm not happy about this, or I'm angry about that, and you automatically go, well, it's because I'm not good enough. And again, we always, for better or worse, talk about Chris's last relationship, where the person he dated, literally like every ounce of him always had to be in like, fill the hole in your soul, fill the hole. And it's an unachievable task, as you said. And so like, if I'm Eric, I would just be like, oh my God, I just said I want to date you. Why are you making it be like, I'm broken, you know?
Yeah.
Like that would be like, if you're the guy, that would scare me, because I would be afraid that was something I was going to have to prove, right? To validate that you're lovable, that I'm not your mom for the rest of my goddamn life. And that would be really intense.
Yeah,
I know. And it's God, I do agree with you ladies that, I think Rachel's slightly, higher chance of better off. And she looks happy, at least in the previews, whereas like Gabby, Rachel's puss is so sad. She's just there and
I Googled, but I didn't find anything. Rachel's body language in the finale.
Yeah.
But I mean, like, I literally, I was like, take the camera off, please, make that, she's going to lose her shit. She's literally going, she's like, Jesse, I'm always on the edge of tears.
I love that. Okay, so I love that because that is, I think that is one of her kind of, if not exactly a core belief, but something that is, I feel like she's still okay with that. Whereas I think Gabby's like, fuck, I'm sick and tired of, I know I sound like a annoying broken record. I'm sorry. I'm going to play this goddamn song one more time. Even to you, aunt, who I guarantee the aunt has heard it a billion times. And so I'm like, shit, if you had to tell the aunt, oh my God, if you're telling your family about your family, then holy moly, I'm pretty sure they already know about it. It's one thing to tell a complete stranger, you know, giving you coffee, you're never going to see again, but people know, but the fact that is actually worrisome. And we talked about like, I mean, yeah, she's set some therapy hours yet to come. I think if she still has to keep regurgitating it over and over again that much.
Yeah. There's this poem that we read at our retreats, and I'm going to give you that very high level, but it's called Autobiography in 5 Chapters. It's by this woman named Portia Nelson. And basically it says, like chapter one, I walk down the street. Yeah. I fall in a hole. It's my fault. It's not my fault. Chapter two, I walk down the hall. I see the hole. I fall in. It's still my fault. Chapter three, I walk in the hole. I fall in. It's my fault. Chapter four, I walk down the street. I fall in. I get out. It's my fault. You know, I walk around the hole. And finally walk down a new street. And I feel like Rachel is just walking down the hall and walking down the street, falling in the hole and going, it's not my fault. And Gabby is like, I'm walking down the street. I fall in the hole. It is my fault, but I still keep falling down the hole.
Love that hole.
Oh my God, that is so good, Marni. That is so accurate. Yeah, that's why I was like, I feel like Gabby, despite, having, I think, probably a worse starting position in all of this, is more advanced. And that's why I have hope for her ability to get out of that hole with Eric and be flexible.
To work on it. Yeah. You know what's really crazy is we know, because Gabby's so out there about her issue. And she has awareness of it, but she hasn't done the work yet to really heal it. We don't know anything about why is Rachel literally have such low self-worth? Like, we have no flipping idea. Like, what did Big Tony do? What happened to that girl? Is that anywhere on the internet? Like, do we know why she is a fall apart and that needs validation?
She seems highly just from her style, I would guess she's perfectionistic and has some belief around any negative emotions are terrible. You see her, she's just always trying to be so happy. There just seems to be a rigidity in her. And where did it come from? I have no freaking idea.
Well, maybe if Big Tony is scary for a reason, maybe Big Tony was do this, be that, be perfect. And so she's this was my big chance to prove that I'm a TV star and I won and I get my little, my little big magic ending. I don't know, but
she's a pilot. There's probably, very high pressure, obviously.
I would not want to be on a plane with Rachel.
No.
Oh my God. There's turbulence.
I would say the opposite. I think that because again, a lot of people develop these qualities because they're functional in some way. So I bet in piloting school and whatever, she probably worked her ass off. She probably got straight A's. She's probably knows every. But the other thing that I was thinking,
let me agree with you because I think this is so important. Because in flying, she feels like she's in control.
She
can control at work, which a lot of you I know listen to. Okay, go ahead. But Dr. Emily.
In flying, there's obviously some, or at least I don't know anything, but I'm guessing there's some, you have to know how to problem solve when bad things happen. That's part of it.
Right.
And so it seems like she needs to transfer that ability, that mindset from piloting to dating and relationships. It just can't be that the plane flies perfectly every single time and everything goes perfect, perfect, perfect. Yeah. That little error light's blinking. I need to know how to fix that. I need to know how to problem solve. Oh, something's wrong with my engine. I need to know how to, like, she's obviously able to do this. She just needs to apply.
I just had a conversation with a woman, Angie, who's like our enrollment coach, and she's a former lawyer. And she said, being a lawyer is not a life skill. Like, right. Like, it's not a life skill. And the skills that you have to be a lawyer don't translate. Like, they don't work in relationship. Right.
Yeah.
And it's almost like for Rachel, like being a pilot, like that's not a life skill. That's not going to help you. Like, crisis management, being able to operate, you know, under like, you know, certain conditions, being able to problem solve, that's only going to work in that situation. Like, you have to learn how to deal with humans, not just a machine, right?
And
I just think that when she feels out of control, this woman loses her bleep, like, oh, like you could just watch that scene with Avon. It's just, oh my God. It's like, I said to Jeremy, oh God, this is like real ugly cry. Like, this is real. Like, this hurts me, you know, it's so sad. So when you think about like why these two ladies ended up with these guys who are basically unavailable at the level at which they thought, do you think it was that they both have broken pickers? Do you think it's that they didn't date very well? They didn't collect data very well. They didn't ask the right questions. Do you think it's just, this is like shitty casting or actually the best evil plan ever, where they just cast people who have no desire to get married on purpose, but not tell the bachelorettes? Like, what do you guys, how do you think they ended up here?
I think it was a lot of the combination of those things. I think it was definitely rushed because there were two people splitting the camera time. I've never been, probably you feel this way, like less invested and as well as hopeful. I've never been less hopeful for pairings for people and being like, you know, really trying to fight for something. Look, we're both cheering for the contestants to leave. We're like, yeah, run. That's the real victory here, is to get away from the from the prizes that are supposed to be won on here. And and I do think that after the Clayton incident, I think it really, and then being chosen on TV, I experienced Rachel is kind of having like this first only child, like first player syndrome, where which is fantastic, by the way, for flying planes, now that I think about it, because you are first player, you are the only, you are the main player in there. Literally think of that as, you know, the opposite is, you know, being a non-playable character, just someone who's not 100% always about them, but in that case, I guess her profession is about her. But just to see how poorly, how things all fall apart. So it's just a zero sum. It's all or nothing for her when somebody has a differing, some, you know, opinion or wants to try something a different way. She, you know, kind of melts down, and I think it's really kind of exposed and opened it up. And then I do think that I thought her picker was freaking, it was pretty dang, it was good. We were like, hey, you even mentioned last week, if you had to force your daughters to get hitched, you'd pick out a couple of her throwaways or runaways, rather, for Rachel's runaways to run towards your daughters. Whereas Gabby, we all loved Gabby. And like, great. She, like you mentioned, she sees the hole. Oh, she's covered in crap, but she's not going to do that. Oh, wait. Oh, she found the hole again. Okay, next episode. Yeah. She will not fall in the hole, but we're watching it over again. And now it looks like the season's ending. And yesterday you saw her again once fall in the hole and crumble. And like Emily said, you said her mind kind of melts down, and she doesn't really know what to make of being loved. There's an interesting scene, Marni. Did you catch the one where he's like, Eric's like trying to pick her or kiss her, and she's like doing this weird face dodging?
Yes, that was like, I need,
don't love me. I'm not ready to be, I'm not lovable.
Well,
I'm not, don't
no, I think it was, you just said some shit and I literally can't deal with it.
I can't so say it. Yeah.
I'm going to just kiss you and make it go away. But he literally says like, I don't want us, either of us, to be pressured or have expectations. Uh-huh. She's like coming in for the kiss, pressure, expectations. She's like, what? And then she's like, wait, never mind. Stick your tongue down my throat. Like, the cameras are here, you know? Oh my God. I just also want Gabby to like someone to like tie her up and make her eat donuts. She's so small. Yeah. I just hope she's healthy. So we've talked about like, this is what happens. Well, I think, so I'll answer my question, then we'll let Emily answer before we wrap up. I think Rachel is solely chosen based on who chooses her. I think you've talked a lot this season about how she's really good at the flirt. She's really good at like, you know, I think she's super fake. And you've seen her, just if she doesn't get picked, she loses her shit. That is so real of what happens in dating, you know, like, oh, the guy, you know, I'm never dating again. I'm deleting all the apps. And then 3 days later, you're like, oh, wait, there's a cute boy on, you know, whatever. Let me try again. And then, oh, this sucks. So I think that it just happened to where she didn't really ask the follow-up questions. I think in the end, when you choose just based on who chooses you, you got to be really honest with yourself and say, like, is this my person? Am I choosing this person just because they want me? Do we have the same goals? Like, am I in for the long term? But she could have been like Vegas lucky if she would have just said to Avon, you know what? This show has ended on a like, get down on my knee and ask you to be my girlfriend. It's happened before. It wouldn't be the first time, right? Like, she could have totally gotten the dress and, you know, done all that.
She can't do it. She can't give up her goal.
And her fantasy.
And that to me is why, and I don't think we haven't really heard Gabby's like, and you know, like Rachel had that talk with Avon on the couch and we haven't really seen that from Gabby yet, but I really have, that talk made me feel even more like Avon is such a great high quality guy. And even more like, Rachel's still stuck in the hole. She's just going to keep walking down the same street, falling in the hole and saying, it's not my fault, because Avon, and I shouted this out, literally like clapped out loud, because I have not heard a contestant on this show in years say, I have regrets. Avon said, I regret not making that more clear from the beginning in Fantasy Suites. And I was literally jaw dropped, because every time we hear these people say, no regrets, I have no regrets, like everything's worked out the way it's supposed to. And it's, to me, what you're saying there is, I didn't learn a single goddamn lesson.
Right.
I learned nothing. I'm going to change nothing about myself. I'm just going to go through life the same. I'm going to keep falling in that same hole over and over and over. And Avon actually sat down and said, wow, I would have done something different there. And I regret the way that I handled that. And I think that is just so powerful and shows like so much, you know, positive like self-growth in him.
Yeah. I mean, I think the big lesson from the season is like, be clear on what you want, say it like early on, and then ask the follow-up question. What does that mean to you exactly? What does that look like? Don't shy away from the vague sort of yes-ish or someday or whatever. And I think it's like a great lesson for men and for women. Like, just be honest, like hurt me now rather than hurt me later. And finally, like, you know, don't try and fix somebody or change someone. You know, I think what did I learn from Gabby, or how did she end up where she is with just Eric? That girl was just like, oh, he likes me. He's so cute. Oh, he likes me. Like, I think I could fix him and help him and whatever. But he's emotionally distant, but that's okay. To where, you know, here there's one guy just kind of there. Again, super lucky. But like, I think that was the path for Gabby, was like, she was like in denial.
Yeah.
Christopher. Marni,
and to your point, what's to give a little throwback to our good friend, the reason you and I are buds after all these years, Matt Boggs, when is not the time to ask a man if he wants to be your long-term partner?
Well, I think there's two versions of it.
What does Matt Boggs say? When is not the time to do it?
Well, when you're naked.
Yeah, that's when they all got their clarity.
Exactly.
Run in your bra. Hey, dude, we're gonna fall. Do what? Yeah, of course.
Yes, and he said, "Oh, you're so smart." Because he said, "I got carried away." It was like I had a big boner. And you're like, "You want to marry me, right?" And he's like, "Yeah." When I was single, my friend Aaron.
Totally.
I know. When I was single, my friend Aaron. Before I knew how to be a girl, I used to go over there and like watch football with him and like, you know, get stoned and eat like watermelon. It was like Seinfeld. And so he would like come back and he would tell me about all these dates. And he was like, it was like Sunday, we're watching football. And he's like, "Oh, I have a girlfriend today." And I'm like, "What?" He's like, "Yeah, I was like literally about ready to put my boner in this girl." And she was like, "This means we're in a relationship, right?" And he was like, "Yeah, you know," and then whatever. And then he was like, "Yeah, I just figured I'd give it today." But it's like, do not ask someone to be, you know, your boyfriend or ask what you're looking for when you're naked. So we always say on our campus end dates, you know, vertical and clothes at the beginning and have those conversations. But you are right, Chris. Like, do not ask somebody, "What are you looking for when you're naked?"
Sure. Thank you.
This is not deep, but. But it's so basic, but yet it can change everything. So next week, oh my God. And then I have to vent for 2 minutes. Like, I think the internet was like, "Fuck you, Jesse." Like, it's the most dramatic ever. And I'm like, are we supposed to believe you? Cause you're not Chris Harrison.
No.
Like, are you saying it better? Or are you saying it more? He's like, "We've asked ABC to give us some more time." I'm like, oh my God. And you know what? For a second, I was like, what is something actually going to happen?
Someone
combust on the stage. But anyway, so they're dragging it out. We have one more week. And I bet that show is literally going to be like 15 minutes and then 45 minutes, probably about like paradise.
Oh, yeah.
I think it's just going to fall apart. They're going to blubber and cry. They're going to introduce Zach and then we're going to talk about paradise. But, and someone will set up a GoFundMe for therapy for both of them. Or just hire me. But anyway, what do you guys think what's your predictions for next week?
I agree. I think I have like an inkling of hope that Gabby and Eric might be dating, not engaged, but dating, but it's so clear. Rachel and Tony are just going to fall apart. And
yeah. I don't even know if that one gets your proposal. I do see this being fake. Like Rachel's like, he comes in, he's like, "You know, I know this wasn't what you wanted, but like, I would love to be your boyfriend." And then hopefully she's like, cool.
Yeah.
Her body language last night didn't seem like, "Why am I here? My life sucks. I can't believe I have to continue this charade." As much as Rachel, who was like, "I cannot believe I have to keep faking that this had any sort of happy ending. Like, just please let this be over. I want to go where like, I feel like Rachel's going to go like, get like, put her head in like a scarf and big glasses and like ride around like Monte Carlo, like in a car, like hoping nobody can recognize me.
Yeah, but begging at the same time.
I am the forlorn, scorned Rachel. Forlorn.
Going that formerly betrothed, but now
exactly. I will just get in my plane and fly away to Antarctica and hope that somebody comes to find me, but they probably won't. All right, fucking A. I think we should get a medal. I mean, I'm exhausted. Okay, first of all, and I have to just say this because it was like literally. Like a refreshing dip in the pool. After Bachelorette, I watched Dated and Related, which I really feel like you guys need to watch on Netflix. It's literally so fun.
I got a screenshot. I sent it to you. There's a couple twins on there, and my friend said, "Oh, it looks like twin Chris Gillis's."
That's what Jeremy said last night. He's like, oh my God, the Wade brothers look like Chris Gillis.
That's what I heard. But now my friend, I sent a photo and everyone said, no, that's not just their Aryan version. Maybe they act like me or talk like me or something. I got to watch them. But all right, if Jeremy said that, then
well, Jeremy didn't even watch the first two episodes. And I was like, can you just watch episode three? And within like 10 seconds, he was like laughing. He had his big like smile when he goes surfing. Like it was that much fun.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, it was just fun. And my God, you know, for all of us in reality dating, Helen, you just don't want to wait till paradise to feel that warm, loving feeling again. Just binge yourself some Dated and Related. There's some awesome American fuckboys that get rejected. And maybe if you watch, we can talk about that because it's really, really fun to watch. Whatever you do, ladies, get a manicure, get a massage, whatever you need to just get through the next couple of weeks, because we will survive, Rachel and Gabby. We will get to paradise. We just have to keep doing a life check. We'll talk to you guys soon. Bye-bye for now. Hey, thanks for tuning into today's show. So if being in an intimate relationship in which you feel 100% seen, heard, and accepted by a high caliber man is a priority for you right now, and you're interested in seeing if you're a fit for working with me and my team at Dating with Dignity, here's what I want you to do. Just head over to DWDVIP, that's D as in dating, W, D as in dating, VIP.com, and book a call to speak with my team. We'll get on the phone with you for about 60 minutes and you'll get crystal clear on what's stopping you from finding true love right now. We'll also take a look at what you want to create, what you want your whole life to look like when you're able to finally be fully expressed as a woman in a healthy relationship with an incredible guy. And if we can help you get from where you are right now to where you want to be, we will show you the fastest path possible that makes sense for you to do that. We help smart, successful women all over the world solve this one missing piece in their life so they can finally have it all. So to see if we can help you do the same thing, head over to DWDVIP.com. I'm Marni Batista, and let's talk soon.